Our reading this morning is going to be in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 17 through 21. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 17 through 21. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation, to wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. As though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. For he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Amen.
Before we get into the sermon, I must express our great appreciation for all of those that are providing meals for us at the house. I kind of think that if you're going to get sick, you're going to be in the hospital, the place to do it, South Day Baptist Church. If the doctor don't make you well, the cooking will. I mean, it's just fabulous. It's just a marvelous display of the true definition of grace. And as a church family, I think you've gone overboard. I mean, we're just a couple of people that work like you do around here. There's no particular merit that we should deserve it, but I will say thank you for it. And it's like God's grace. There's nothing that we deserved about God's grace, but we always express our gratitude towards him for what he's given. So thank you very much. We do appreciate it. And I'll figure out how I'm going to work off the extra pounds as time goes by. One way or another, we'll get that part straightened out. But in the meanwhile, I'm just going to indulge and enjoy. Thank you, wife, for hurting yourself, because I'm just having a great time in all this. The only issue we do have at home is I am not a hairdresser, obviously. And so there is this little routine that I just cannot get it down. So finally, I said, just deal with it. That's the pastoral answer. If we don't have a solution to it, just deal with it, and we'll be going. All right, I'm going to take a pause so that when they edit the live stream DVD, she'll be able to pick up where Charlie left off in its reading. All things from God. That's the text, that's the verse that out of chapter 5 of 2 Corinthians in verse 18. When we look at this and the verses that surround it, we're going to spend time this morning just on that thought of all things from God. We're going to put it into its context, and as we look at the context, we'll begin to see that Paul was not just making an all-inclusive statement whereby, you know, we may say, well, no matter what happens, no matter what we receive, no matter what it is, it's all of God. Well, there's truth to that statement, but when Paul makes that comment here, he's doing it in a very theological way. He's narrowing it down to the very essence, the very root of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. In just a couple of weeks, on April 4th, Sunday morning, we will have our sunrise service. We'll have our Easter cantata. We'll have the breakfast. We'll have all of those things that we do as a church because we're celebrating a very special day, the death, the burial, primarily the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So in God's providence, the text of Scripture that we'll have between now and then will immediately draw our attention to the fact that redemption and salvation and the invitation, all those things are of God. And so that's where we will go on this journey here this morning. So our text that we have, we'll read it again so that we find our place, and we're only going to be going up to verse 19. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. And behold, all things are become new, and all things are of God, who have reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ and has given to us the ministry of reconciliation, to witness, or to wit, that God was in Christ, reconciled the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. So with that, let's open up with a word of prayer and ask God's presence, ask God by his Holy Spirit, that he will instruct us into this divine truth and the wonderful words of life that he has for us here this morning. So Father, we commit this sermon into your care. These are your words right out of the scripture, and we know that as the Holy Spirit drafted those words through chosen men, as you breathe these thoughts into them, and now we have it in our possession. We ask, Lord, that that same Holy Spirit would be our teacher, our guide, the one that would be the surgeon of our hearts to help us to rightly divide the word of God, that it might prove itself to be profitable in righteousness and correction and reproof and whatever it is that we continue to grow and to be rooted and grounded in Christ. Help this text today bring to our mind the centrality, the most important person in our lives, in the universe, through Jesus Christ, him alone. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So as we look at this, we have the one word phrase circled there, all things are of God. And this passage includes with it then, there are three major assertions that are being made. Now this is not the outline, although you're going to find these three thoughts arise as we progress through this. Number one is the fact that God is the driving force of redemption of mankind. Redemption, salvation, reconciliation, justification, all of the words that we use, and some of those we'll explain as we go along. God is the driving force behind all of that. It comes solely at God's initiative. He acted first. We as people, humanity, are the recipients. As we go along, we will find that this continued emphasis, the continued assertion that it's God that moved toward us. Secondly, God acted through Christ's death and Christ alone as the means of reconciliation. So in this action to draw men onto himself, to bring peace between the enemy of God and God himself, in order to do that, it would be through Jesus Christ and him alone. And then thirdly, God continues to act through those who have been reconciled. We see that as we get to the latter part of the text, to wit that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing the trespasses onto them, and then committed onto us this ministry of reconciliation. So God, as the initiator, the sole driving force, God acted through Christ's death, and then God dispatches, employs, ordains the believer to be the one that is now going to carry that message, that word of reconciliation out. Now, here are the three thoughts that we'll draw from this phrase this morning found in verses 17, 18, and that is this. All things related to transformation. When he says all things are of God, the first part that we want to do is go back to verse 17, because Paul is alluding to verse 17. That's what prompted the thought. All things that relate to our transformation, all things that relate to our reconciliation. So what is involved in that? What are the words that are used? What action did God take? And the explanation of those things. And then all things are of God, that is all things that are related to the proclamation. So we have the transformation of the individual where he becomes a believer in Jesus Christ. We have the reconciliation of that same individual and the offers out onto the world. And then we have the all things that pertain unto the proclamation of that word of reconciliation. All of this is what we'll mine out of our passage here this morning. So our reading once again, but as we do it, we notice this. Any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things are become new. That's our transformation. So we look at that. We understand that what has taken place is a work of God. And then seconds, we read, all things are of God who hath reconciled us unto himself. That is where we get the idea of the all things pertaining to our reconciliation. And then he's given unto us this ministry. So now we have that which pertains to the proclamation. So in that text of scripture, you can easily see that we're dealing with how God transformed our lives, something that was old, recreated us entirely, moves us then toward that of being reconciled unto himself, and then dispatches us to be the proclaimers of this wonderful truth of the gospel. So you have transformation and then reconciliation, and that then of proclamation of this same gospel. Well, the first thing that we observe when we talk about all things that pertain to our transformation, that we have to understand. Sometimes we just have to remind ourselves that there is nothing in and of ourselves that would ever bring us into a right standing before God. That we cannot in any way, shape, or form, as you see on the list, bring about a new soul. Work all you want, scrub it all you want, do as much praying and baptizing and sanitation of your heart and your soul. Nothing changes. It is fallen. It is possessed by the sin nature. It is Adamic. That Adam is the representative of a fallen human race. And so we receive, however, the new soul, not of ourselves, but of God. We have a new body that is guaranteed to us when we arise, the day that Jesus calls us, or the day that you die, we are in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ, redeemed. We have a new worship, whereby we worship God now in spirit and in truth, compared to the old manner of worship with a sacrifice on the altar and having a priest. And by the way, we might as well bring that up. We have a new priest. We have one priest rather than 1,000 priests. The priesthood is being done away with. Christ is that high priest. We have a new temple, which actually is our body. So rather than going into a temple of stone, the Spirit of God dwells within us. You are the temple of the Holy Spirit. We have a new city that is given to us. We have a new heart, a heart of flesh and not of stone. God tells us in Ezekiel that he will take hearts that are of stone and change them to a heart of flesh. We have new manna. Rather than going out day by day and picking it up off the ground, we have the bread of life, which is found in Jesus Christ. We have new water. We have the living water. Jesus says that any man that receives him, that he will bring out from within him, his innermost being, the living water, the Holy Spirit of God. There's no way that we could ever do this much. So it is of God and nothing of ourselves. That's why when we sing, the choirs would sing the hymn this morning, and then we sing our hymns, the references to which is of providence, of how God brings song and service together, all of those references of being only a sinner saved by grace, a sinner that received the kindness and the goodness of God. That's where we are all at and were at one point in time when we come to know Jesus Christ. So the transformation, God bringing us and giving us all of these new things. And we must also consider there are some things that we cannot do. So those are the list of the things that God gave to us that we have become, but there are things that we cannot do. We cannot be reconciled to God on our own terms. Nobody can do that. As much as people try and invent ways and means to be able to restore a fallen relationship, or at least earn God's favor, to gain God's attention, to give them a special discount, hopefully being able to enter into the kingdom of God, it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen because we cannot appease God's anger. That is something that only the atonement can do. And so you have in the scriptures that word that is very difficult to pronounce sometimes, propitiation. It simply means that Jesus Christ is the appeasement for God. It settled the matter of justice and anger and wrath, and all of that was satisfied through Jesus Christ as individuals. No matter how hard we would try, there's no way that we could placate or or appease wrath, because wrath is necessary when there is sin and an insult against holiness. There are no exceptions to that. It is the nature of God. It is who he is to express his anger for those that sin against his holiness, and for a creation, humanity, to rebel against the Creator, no matter what level of rebellion it might be. And so it incurs wrath, and that wrath must be appeased. Certainly, we cannot satisfy justice. Justice is the answer to the fact that crime committed, and justice means that there's a penalty that must be served, a penalty that has to be meted out. And the criminal, the offender, is responsible to take upon himself the penalty for his actions. So sinful mankind, without Christ, would be doomed to an eternal destiny in hell, without God, without hope, forever and ever and ever, and no amen. But the only reason that has changed is because Jesus Christ satisfied the justice of God so that he could be both just and the justifier of the ungodly. And we cannot conform to his standard of righteousness. It's impossible. That's why it's necessary that God gives to us his righteousness. So when you take into consideration, there are three key words in here. We have appeasement, we have that of satisfaction, and we have that of righteousness. So when the Bible tells us to witness that God is in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, that means that Jesus satisfied the appeasement for wrath because of sin and judgment. Then judgment is satisfied through Jesus Christ, because the penalty that would be ours, Christ took it upon himself. He bore the penalty of our sin upon his body as he would hang on the tree, and then forever and ever, never being able to conform to the righteous standard to fully uphold all of the jot and tittle of the law, impossible for any human being, no matter how pristine he might be in his character. Only Jesus was able to do that. And so therefore, because of Christ, the standard of righteousness is met, not by us, but Christ gives to us, God through Christ gives to us his righteousness. So now we inherit, we have been credited with the righteousness of Jesus Christ. God does not see our fallenness. He does not see the ugliness of sin, but rather he sees the virtue and the purity and the garments of holiness that are found in Jesus Christ. That's what it is to be saved. That's what it is to say that only a sinner saved by grace, we have received grace from God, and these are the components that pertain to it. So God becomes the driving force of redemption of humankind, and reconciliation comes solely at God's initiative. We may try, people may attempt it, but in the end, judgment day is going to come. The only thing that they're going to have to offer to God, found in Revelation chapter 20, is that when the books were open and the names are found that are in the book of life, and the ones whose names were not found in the book of life, they were judged according to their works and then cast into the lake of fire. So the works, if that's what people live by, and that's what you're hanging your eternal life on, is how well you do and making up some story about God. Well, God is a God of love, so he would never put anybody in hell. Judgment Day, Revelation chapter 20, he says, you will have the opportunity to display your good works. And I want you to know ahead of time that from that text of scripture, your good works, not of anybody, prove anything. They go to the pit with you, and they will all go up in smoke. So we go to the next thought, the things related to reconciliation. This is the best part of the whole story. This is the part that really unwraps what is involved, what it is to be reconciled unto God. So one of the bullet points of the main assertion is this, that God acted through Christ's death. And Christ alone. Kind of like bear that thought in your mind. Christ alone is the means of reconciliation. So in verse 13, all things are of God who has reconciled us to him. That is the story. That's what it is. God reconciled the enemies of the cross, us, to himself by Jesus Christ. Now, you know what I mean when we say God made the initiative. Helpless humanity with a fallen nature was unable and has the inability to be able to meet appeasement, satisfaction, and righteousness. But God takes the initiative through Christ and reconciles this fallen world to himself. Now, it's not carte blanche. It's not something that Christ died for the sins of the world and everybody is ushered in under this umbrella of redemption. It does require the act of faith. It does require seeing our guiltiness and our sinfulness and calling upon the name of the Lord. It requires knowing that we are undone and lost without hope in this world and that we need a Savior. And so all of that is necessary on the part of the listener, on the part of the one that is being invited to be reconciled to God through Jesus Christ. So God's observation, number one, God is a Savior by his very nature. The very nature of God speaks that he wants to rescue and save the world. So before the foundation of the world, Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 4, we read these words, according as he has chosen us in him, in Christ. Remember, God reconciling the world unto himself through Christ. But before the world was even fashioned. Now, I know you're going to struggle with this, but here's the truth. God is a Savior before the world was created. And in the process of doing that, he's chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. Don't worry about the chosen and who's not chosen, etc. Rejoice for the fact that if you know Christ as your Savior, your name was in the book of life before the foundation of the world. And you're here because you acted in faith from the word of truth. And you believed that. And you trusted in Christ. You weren't just all of a sudden wake up one day and praise God, I'm saved. Amen. There was the preaching of the word, the work of the Holy Spirit. There was the minister of the word. There was the word reconciliation. Your heart was moved. And then you find yourself as one of the chosen. Because God chose you before the foundation of the world. He wants to be a Savior. He is the Savior. By his very nature, he is interested in the redeeming the lost. Ezekiel chapter 34 and verse 16. He tells us this, I will seek that which was lost and bring again that which was driven away. That is the character of a Savior. Jesus put it this way, he comes to save and to seek those that are lost. Those that are well do not need a physician. So Jesus was willing to set aside the 99 to find the one. And that is the nature of God. That is what Christ is, that Savior. And he describes himself as a Savior in Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 3, where he points out that he is the one that would be the Savior to Israel. In 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 10, Paul writes, he said, we suffer reproach because of our faith in Jesus Christ, because we trust in the living God, note this, who is the Savior of all men, especially those that believe. I phrase it this way. He is the Savior that is available to all men, and he becomes the Savior, the one that saves and the rescued to those who believe. So the first notation is this, that God is a Savior by his very nature. That's who he is. And when you and people have to understand that this is his heart. When we enter into the sunrise service and we enter into the Resurrection Sunday, and as the universal title is given, Easter Sunday, we understand those terms. But the most important thing is this. It is the fullest display of the nature of Jesus Christ to rescue and to save the world at great cost. And that is why God would do that. And the price would be his son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Secondly, Jesus is the means of reconciliation. So when we take into consideration what is being stated here, much more than being justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more than being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. So the three words that arise out of the text or that are of our interest today is the fact that we are justified, and then the word enemies, and then we are reconciled. And these come together in Romans. Where you're at now is actually in Romans chapter 5, verses 10 and 11. Romans chapter 5. So in these verses from 9 to 11, Paul makes the transition from justification to reconciliation. And he does it as he describes that we are justified, declared righteous, we were the enemies of God, now we are reconciled to him. So what is it to be reconciled? To be reconciled, it immediately assumes that there is a tension, there is an enmity, there is a hostility to between the two parties. And so to be reconciled is to end the relationship of enmity. End that relationship of that enmity. We are enemies of the cross. If while when we were the enemies of God, he reconciled us unto himself through Jesus Christ. Colossians 1 and verse 20. And having made peace. So when we end the relationship of enmity, that is the first step. But something, remember the put off and the put on of last week. To put off the hostility, God puts on the peace. So it's not moving from hostility to neutrality. It's not a bookkeeping correction that sets the record straight. God's terms of reconciliation is to take the identification of enemies and transform them into that of a peaceful relationship, and whereby they now become friends. And so that's why Colossians best describes it. Having made peace with enemies through the blood of his cross to reconcile all things, there's our word again, to himself, whether in earth or things in heaven, was through Jesus Christ and that reconciliation. Secondly, peace is not just a cessation of hostilities, but it is a truce. It refers to mending the broken relationship that results of God justifying us, that is, he makes us right through faith and changing us from enemies into that of being friends. This is rather unique. We have forensic language. We have forensic language, and then we have family language that is found in Romans chapter 5, verses 9 and 10. The forensic language is it. In other words, the legal terminology is the fact that we have a judge. The judge sits on the bench, and the judge makes a decision. He renders a verdict. The judge, in this case, being Jesus Christ, so we're going to carry the two parallel thoughts. So a criminal is in the court, and the criminal is declared to be set free. In other words, he is not charged with his crime at the word of the judge. So the judge dismisses the individual. That individual, at that point in time, never wants to be in that courtroom again, and the judge probably has no interest in ever seeing that person, that man, in his court. So forensically, justification means that you've been declared right. You have been assigned justice. You are right with God. Reconciliation takes it a step further. In the Bible, God as the judge, because he was the one that was offended, because the criminal was an enemy with him and sinned against him. So God, as this judge, not only declares that individual righteous, but now he seeks to reconcile that same sinner onto himself into a relationship of adoption, a relationship of being a friend. God seeks out. He goes to the next level. He goes to the next step. This is what is the beautiful part of what it is to be reconciled. So when he says, now he makes peace. In the courtroom, the judge is not interested in making peace with the criminal. He's just been declared, right? You're dismissed. You've been acquitted. You've been set free. You're no longer charged with the crimes against you. Don't ever come back into my court. But in God's court, it is, you are set free. You have been acquitted. The charge is no longer held against you. You will not be penalized for your crime. Why? Because he made the effort through Jesus Christ. Now, not only that, he's going to reconcile that individual, us, to himself through Christ. So he establishes a peaceful relationship between God and the enemy. The enemy now becomes the friend of God. It's a very unique, odd story. But that is a story of redemption. This is what God does. And so we look at this, the change it brings about, reconciliation between God and man, takes place in men and not in God. You got to understand that. The Greeks had the idea that it was God that had the problem. He was kind of out of sorts with humanity, and he would have to make changes in order to receive people, in order that people could be come into his presence. The Jewish mindset, the biblical worldview is this: God is righteous, God is just, God is love, God is a savior, God is angry against sin. But man is God, the one with the problem. Man is the one that initiated the enmity. Man is the one that rebelled against God. A fallen man from Adam and Eve, and continued to live that way forever and ever. And it's always going to be that way. The only thing that can happen is if God intervenes and reconciles, makes peace by the blood of his cross, and brings humanity into a right relationship with himself. So God justifies, therefore, that is, he declares us righteous, and God also reconciles, that is, he brings man into a peaceful relationship with himself, and never forget the language there, through the blood of his cross. Not just by a statement, hey, I want you to be my friend, you are pardoned, you are redeemed, you are set free, you are not guilty. That's not what he's doing. That all happened, but it happened through Christ, through Jesus. He died and he paid all for all of that to make all that possible. And that is the reconciliation side of it that we enjoy as believers, that any individual can enjoy the blessing of what it is to be saved and to be at peace with God, to be brought into the courtroom as a friend. And not only that, he invites you home for dinner. You won't find that happening in local courts unless you happen to be the neighbor to the judge. And he says, hey, come on over, forget about the court thing. I know you were a criminal an hour ago. You've been pardoned. I want you to come over and we're having a barbecue tonight. That's not really going to happen. But in God's economy, through Jesus Christ, we will enjoy the marriage supper of the Lamb. We will be invited to attend the largest festivity of wedding that you will ever witness in your lifetime. And that is because we will be the bride of Christ. Not only now were enemies made peace with God by reconciliation, but the enemy now becomes the bride of Christ. So we've not only come from a point of hostility and loss, but we're elevated to the position of being the very virtuous bride of the Savior, of the judge himself. What a blessing. One's heart has to reflect and meditate upon that. Let's look at the point quickly, and that is the things that are related to proclamation. You find this in verse 8:19. We'll pick up at the bottom part of verse 18. He has given unto us the ministry of reconciliation. In this ministry, then, there is this message, that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, And then we go back to this ministry, but now the change. And it committed unto us the word of reconciliation. So you make two observations very clearly. You have the ministry of reconciliation, and you have the word of reconciliation. You might say that they're one and the same, but in a way they are not. Because Paul did a change up for a reason. The word ministry there is the same word that we for the use of the word a servant. Or in the original language, it was depicted oftentimes as a slave. So, again, let's go back to what we were. The status of being an enemy. The identifier of fallen humanity, enmity with God, an enemy of God, enemies of the cross. A child of the devil, forever lost. And now we come to the point that being reconciled to God, we have a peaceful relationship. So now God, part of all things are passed away. The enemy status is passed away. All things are become new. Now we become what? We become the servant of the message. We become the servant of the judge. We become now the ministers. We become the slaves of God, who has a message to redeem the world, to let others know that there is a word of reconciliation. Now, I make a somewhat of a big deal out of this one word because it has everything to do with the attitude as believers that we should have when we ever speak to anybody about salvation. When we think and we hear of those that are lost and the criminal acts that people do, anything from taking candy out of a store to abortion to skewed views of what it is with sexual identity, marriage and divorce. You could just go down the list of all the sins, substance abuse that are in the world. And we oftentimes, as believers, we brought this up in the men's prayer meeting yesterday. Oftentimes, as believers, we know the truth, but yet in that knowledge puffs up. There can be a sense of high-mindedness whereby we look at a lost and fallen world with a critical spirit and not a compassionate spirit. So when Paul says we are the ministers of reconciliation, his status, his social status, even in God's economy, the social status is this: I am a slave, and I'm witnessing to other people who also are in slavery. He puts himself socially, emotionally, and perspectively at the same level of humanity that he once was. And he understands their predicament. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. So the minister of reconciliation doesn't enter into it with a high-mindedness and a pride. Here's the way, the truth, and life. Either receive it or reject it. It's on you, buddy. But rather, he approaches it as a slave. He has the master, God himself, who saved him. So you remember the story in the book of Luke of the servant that owed just a handful of cash to the 10,000 talents to his Lord. And his Lord was moved with compassion, and he forgave. He released him, and he set him free, debt free. The man goes out and finds somebody that owed him probably 1/100th of the total bill of what he was just been redeemed. And then he charges that man with theft and has him cast in prison. Now, the problem was he failed to realize the saving grace of the Lord of his life, who relieved him of the entire debt. And because of that, he would go to a fellow servant, a fellow slave, and charge him with holding on to money that wasn't even his. And so when we can bring that over to what we're looking at right now, the servant of the message, the servant of Christ with the message of reconciliation, he has the spirit and the humility of that of a slave. In Job chapter 33 and verse 5, when Elihu is attempting to speak to Job, he says two things to him. Number one, I am created by God just like you are. I am given life by God just like you are, because God created me and God breathed his spirit in me. And then he says, Job, I want you to listen to what I have to say. Stand up and give your attention. Why? I'm going to speak to you. I am a pinch of clay like you are. Job, I, Elihu, am here as your friend. I am here. I am created out of the same mud that you were created from. So I have nothing above you. I have nothing against you. I understand your predicament. And so Elihu is inviting Job, but the words that Elihu chooses in such a way that he doesn't present himself as one that is above him or over him or superior to him, but rather equal in his nature by virtue of his creation. And so when we look at this and we see that we have the ministry of reconciliation, you look at it this, as a servant that has a gift to offer to other fallen creatures where I once was. I've been relieved of the debt, and so therefore I want to express that same grace and that same mercy. So what is the message? The message, so you have the method and the message. The message is this. It's found that in verse 19, to witness that God was in Christ, so we have Christ as the predominant one, the initiator, reconciling the world onto himself, and part of the message is that they will not be charged with their trespasses, not imputing their trespasses against them. So it's a way of saying that through Jesus Christ, all crimes, all sin, all rebellion, all the work of being an enemy of God, all of that is not going to be charged. It will not be on your account any longer. That ledger aspect is going to be wiped clean, but it was cleansed, washed away by the blood of Jesus Christ. That is the heartbeat of the reconciliation message. That is the message that we have, that the God's provision is found through Jesus Christ. So as messengers, with the servant's heart, the attitude of humility, I have no way bigger, better than what you are. As you talk to that friend, that neighbor, that homeless individual, it doesn't matter. As you talk to that individual that doesn't fully understand creation and the created in God's image, sanctity of life, sexual identity, it doesn't matter. They may not understand it. Remember, a fallen, darkened world, blinded by the devil, by the father of this world. And so you invite and we pray as the servant heart, humbly asking God to recreate light. And rather than trying to figure out why people do not understand, we just introduce them that through Christ, your confusion, your sin, your rebellion will not be charged against you, but rather you will be imputed with, you will be given the credit of the righteousness of Christ will be granted to that individual that comes to Christ and trusts him as his Savior. So we have transformation, we have the reconciliation, and we have the proclamation. Let's bow our heads in prayer, because at this time, Father, the emphasis is on the work, the initiative that you would take to establish peace between a fallen humanity, enmity, the enemies of God, rebellion against God, all of that, you would make the way through Christ to have all that washed away, done away with, establish a peaceful relationship, to be reconciled, to become friends, justified, saved by your grace. Lord, if there be one here today that has not enjoyed the blessing of forgiveness, if there be anybody here today that is trying any other way or thinks in any form or fashion that Christianity can be adopted or inherited or it grows into you, remind him, Father, that the initiative is of you through Christ, through faith in his blood, saving the soul from perdition and bringing them into the peaceful, right relationship with God through Jesus. Calling upon the name of the Lord to trust them that he would save them from their sins and restore, renew, to be the new creature, the new creation in Jesus Christ. As believers, we pray, Father, that we would have humble spirits and compassion to know that the unsaved world, with all the things that they say, we ask, Father, that our hearts would understand they really do not understand what they are doing, because the God of this world has blinded their eyes that they cannot and will not believe. But only through Jesus Christ can you speak the glorious light of the gospel into their heart, a sovereign God acting on their behalf. We pray that you would do that and help us as believers to trust you for that. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.